There was a great article in the Daily News by a father of twin girls, I believe, or twin kindergartners, that said back in December of 13th, and he was saying that my one child, this twin, is in one classroom, one child's in another classroom, and the difference in education is like night and day. And the final line, I don't know why, how this came up, but the final line was, you know, we got to work to get this teacher evaluation system done because we're going to lose money and my kids are going to be hurt by it. That was December 13th. Now, do you acknowledge, all three of you, acknowledge that there are good teachers and there are bad teachers? Mm-hmm. All right. And you acknowledge that good teachers should be praised and remunerated in accordance with that excellence, and bad teachers shouldn't be teaching. Correct? Mm-hmm. All right. Nobody else is answering, but I assume that's, I would hope.
Well, it's just like okay. In any profession, you wouldn't want a
exactly.
bad cop or
there's
a
good,
bad legislator.
There's
you know.
Good legislators, but.
There you go.
There's good yeah. good union officials, bad union officials.
Yeah, and we could go on for hours.
Yeah, okay.
About this.
And yes. My point is, so there is a need for somehow for this state to evaluate teachers so that we accommodate this poor father who's got two identical twins, one's learning, one's excited, one's not interested in school at all, or can result in that type of situation. So the whole purpose of all of this stuff we're going through and have been going through for a while is to find out an evaluation system. Now, to me, now this is pretty arcane, but to me, I think every principal in every school and all the other teachers know who the good teachers are and who the bad teachers are. And Andy Lanz has mentioned that the good teachers are not the problem and so forth, but the bad teachers are. And it's remarkable to me that everybody who professes to want quality educations for their kids can't figure out the best way to evaluate teachers when everybody knows the good ones and the bad ones. Now, that's a statement from me,
mm-hmm.
okay? Now, a question from me, and hopefully this will put to bed this issue of negotiations for this teacher's evaluations that we're going at. Very simply, did you demand at the 11th hour to double the number of grievances that are brought to arbitration? Yes or no?
No.
Did you bring that up, whether it was the 11th hour or any earlier hour?
Arbitration was discussed.
Well, I'm asking specifically. That doesn't answer the question.
There were numerous proposals at different times, but arbitration was discussed, and it was discussed in a, what we wanted to do was set up sort of a dispute reform process. So I have to be clear in explaining this. What I said was you do one arbitration a day at this moment. Let's take a class size arbitration. We have an entire day with an arbitrator to do one class size arbitration. What is the arbitrator going to ask you in a class size arbitration? Any idea?
I have no clue.
How many kids are in the class? Because it's the class size of the class. So we have the class size is supposed to be at 32, there's 34. It's pretty simple arbitration, isn't it? To me, it's an entire waste of everyone's time. So what I said and what I had proposed to them was all of these issues should be put on a very simple menu. Class size things, process pieces, everything else. I said, force both sides to do 10 arbitrations in a day, and maybe we could stop talking about arbitration so much because all the issues that come up in dispute would be taken care of.
Now,
so in that conversation going back and forth, we were throwing numbers all over the place. To me, it is ridiculous that you have to spend an entire day on something that is so simple. So when we were talking about this new evaluation process, when we had worked out the process of how observations we're gonna do, how things were, I said, why would we even bother with this? Why don't we just say you can do 10 arbitrations in a day? And they were like, oh, you just wanna do more arbitrations. You're trying to double those numbers, make it 10 times what we would normally do. And I said, it's not about making 10 times what we normally do. The issue is about get the facts on the table, force both sides to present their case, get it settled, and move forward.
And what,
I thought that was a good idea.
And what does this have to do with our teacher evaluations?
Because as you implement a new process inside of the school, we have 1,706 schools in New York City. So I am sure that some people will do it not correctly. So somebody has a right to say, look, they're not doing this right.
And you already had a grievance procedure in place in your current contract.
We have a grievance procedure in place.
Okay.
But what we said was...
So that wasn't an essential issue in teacher evaluations. If you already had a grievance procedure in place, it wasn't certainly enough to torpedo this discussion.
No, actually, we had settled that issue.
That was settled?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I guess we're really at the end of this thing because someone ain't being totally forthright, and I'm not accusing either side, but this is absurd. And you wonder this poor... I hope this person who wrote this article about his twin sons looks at this and says, all right, no wonder we've got bad teachers in the schoolroom. We can't even agree on how to evaluate. It's just disgusting. It's absolutely disgusting. And we're stuck with bad teachers who are not, clearly not the majority, the small minority that causes so much trouble. And sometimes I wonder whether the concern of the unions is more to protect that bad teacher than it is to make certain, let me finish, to make certain that the system, rather than making certain that the system works so we weed out the bad teachers. You want to respond? Go ahead.
Yeah, there's a lot more to providing high quality teaching in every classroom. There's pre-service education training in the colleges. There's good induction practices. There's support in the early years. You don't have great teachers just walking in as novices when they're 22, 23 years of age. And we've got a 47% attrition rate by year 5 in teaching. That causes a revolving door. That's no good for students. So you can't make people go into teaching if you don't support it properly, if their class sizes are too big, if the professional development is cut all across the state and wiped out, if they don't have the instructional technologies, and according to a survey, that's taken a huge hit in the last few years. It takes a lot more than just, quote, weeding out a few teachers. You have to develop good teachers. You have to help those who may have promise but need extra help to become highly qualified teachers. So we would ask that you look at the broad array of support that teachers need and schools need to make sure that every classroom is staffed appropriately.
But despite all that, whatever you provide, there still are teachers that don't meet the qualifications, correct? That don't meet the performance. Is that fair to say?
Michael Mulgrew does a good job defending himself, but he agreed to an expedited hearing process in the last contract. We agree to a 100-day hard rule. So we have gone a long ways towards creating more streamlined, efficient processes. And I know UFT has.
And you talk about efficiencies. Assemblywoman Nolan requested some information from the Department of Ed about how many kids take physics exams. So the Wi-Fi in here is not so good, but we were able to get that. And we didn't have to wait 3 years. So just a piece of information. In 2011, physics, 48,555 students took the test. 89% passed at 55 and 79% passed at 65. If we get to a better place with better Wi-Fi, we'll get you the rest of that stuff pretty quickly.
The question was how many took it in the Bronx?
Right, we couldn't get that. Maybe the
we'll get better Wi-Fi and then you can get it, okay?
Right.
Now,
and the issue of your characterization that this is what we focus our time on is completely wrong. We were up here to change the law. We changed the law that says if you're struggling, and we do have, the biggest problem we face as a profession is our attrition rate. The countries that we are in the direct competition to that we hear constantly all have retention rates over 90% of their teaching force. Why? Because they support them properly. They have training when they come in to allow them to develop and become better teachers. That is why we supported the law that was changed in this state. The law that also said, if you are struggling and are an ineffective teacher 1 year, you get 1 year of help. And if you're not better by then, you are leaving this profession. So what you're talking about is something that was already built into the law. But we, at the same time, as you talk about that small number, as you put it, the lack of having an evaluation system that's very supportive for teachers is causing more damage, because if we had more teachers getting more support, children would be getting a better education. So the focus on this piece over here is also very frustrating to us, because we'd rather work on the focusing of all of the rest of the teachers and helping them get better throughout their careers, because that would lead to better outcomes for children.
Okay, and you agree that after this support that you're given for a year, 2 years, 3 years, whatever number of years.
1 year.
1 year.
Well, let's suppose it was even more than that. At some point in time, it's evident to everyone, including the people you represent and your leadership, that this teacher is never going to do good for this kid. What do you do then? Do you have any active role in saying, you know, administration, we want to help you because this is hurting our profession?
The law and the appeal process that we have already agreed upon, which you guys put into last year's budget, says very simple. The presumption at that hearing, at that moment in time for that teacher after 1 year of help, is the presumption is that that person is ineffective, so therefore they are leaving the profession.
Okay. Now, how many school districts do you, how many school districts do you have where there's teachers that you represent in the state?
700.
Close to 700.
700. How many of those did not meet the teacher evaluation requirement by January 17th?
Handful.
Pardon me?
Handful.
What, I didn't
understand. A few. I don't know the exact number. I think it's under 10.
Under 10. Could you give advice to the city school district and the mayor as to how you miraculously did this out of 700 school districts?
I have a perfect piece of advice.
Okay.
They should get a new mayor.
Okay.
We're working on that.
You will have one pretty soon.
That's good.
Okay. Now, was there any model? Did you look, Mr. Mulgrew, did you look at any of the models that they had that would have
yes.
been successful to you? And did you agree, or did you offer to agree to any of the models that had already been approved by the commissioner?
We discussed models with this city, but as you heard the mayor say, that all the other plans are shams. So
were any of your plans fraudulent or shams with the complicity of the commissioner of education?
No, obviously not. The commissioner has high integrity individual, and the U.S. Ed Department oversees that process as well because it's part of an agreement through Race to the Top.
Okay. Okay, well, 1 second. I just wanted to make sure there was one other thing I think I can't remember.
In fact, SED has on a website that what they consider their top 10 plans, and there are very interesting components from other districts. We were looking specifically more at the scoring issues because, as Senator Lanza brought up, that seems to be a great concern of ours, but some of them have some very interesting scoring pieces. Peer observation issues where Rochester has developed an exceptional peer observation program that's recognized throughout this country. Schenectady has a model program, especially on their formulas. It looks very promising. We have about 40 of them sitting in the UFT in where we were negotiating with them, going back and forth to them with the Department of Education.
And none were acceptable to both you and the mayor? None of these 40?
They were not interested in copying another district's plan.
Okay. All right. I think we've probably beat this to death.